And for those of you who are going to get in the comments, oh, you like a whole lot of red, you like a whole lot of trash, this album is not that bad. It got a couple of misses. It got a lot of misses, actually. It's like 5 out of 10 for me, but this is one of those songs I like from this project. What's going on, everybody? It's your boy, Mystic Wolf, and happy holidays. I hope you guys had a wonderful Merry Christmas and are having an awesome holidays with your family, friends, and family members. If you guys are social distancing or not really with family, just know that I hope you guys are still remaining safe and you guys are still communicating whatever you guys do to communicate nowadays. I don't know, your phone, iPod, tablets, they are creating a lot of things for this new generation that you guys, it's almost impossible that you guys can't even communicate. Kind of show you what I got for Christmas before we really get into the video. So if you guys know, I love Persona 5. It's one of my favorite video games I played this year, and I got a concept book for it. Basically it shows like all of the freaking art and stuff. It's a Japanese book and all this is in Japanese, but like I know the English, like the American version doesn't have this type of quality of drip, so I had to get this. I also got myself a cassette player, you know what I'm saying? So I wanna play my cassettes. Like say for example, if I wanna play this, we got it on cassettes. And if you guys noticed, you know how I got all this light coming in, it's actually nighttime the way I'm filming it right now. I got myself a little UBC size, you know, those little tabletop like little tripods where like it has like the light. I finally got a stand for my phone and I got good lighting, so you guys will see more good quality videos with good lighting like this, so I don't have to worry about my phone tripping off at all. So that's awesome. But today we're not here to talk about that. We're here to talk about my favorite top 10 favorite albums of this year. I know I said favorites twice. Now, before I get started, please get a, you know, let's have a little disclaimer that if I don't mention your favorite album, please do not get mad in the comment section below. We're just trying to have some fun. I just want to reflect back onto the year of the favorite albums that I listened to this year. So if you guys didn't see your favorite album mentioned into this list, don't get mad. Just, you know, put in the comment section below what albums I missed. You know, let's have a healthy discussion about favorite music that we really listened to and that meant a lot for us this year. Without further ado, let's get into my top favorite albums of 2020. I actually made flashcards so that way I don't get lost while, like, you know, I'm talking and stuff. So, you know, I'm gonna be rambling a lot, but these flashcards will help me, you know, get me through what I need to get through. Number 10 spot is Victoria Monet with Jaguar. If you guys don't know, Victoria Monet is low-key like my celebrity crush. Like, don't tell Georgia Smith I said that though. She's wrote for like Nas, Lupe, Ariana Grande, Chris Brown, you know, all the other shows. She's a mother now, obviously. That's you know, kind of felt kind of way, but you know what, congratulations for her being a mother. She's expected to have a baby sometime next year, so that is really awesome for her. This EP is also has a Christmas arrangements if you guys want to listen to that on Apple Music. It's actually really, really good, so you guys should really tune into that. But anyway, this album is a very sensual, sharp, beautiful EP that embraces her body and her sexuality. This album was low-key like the soundtrack for like a girl I used to like around this time of year. So, you know, I don't know, when I was listening to like songs like Touch Me, Ass, like that dive experience and moment, I don't know, I always really got a sense of, you know, joy when I was listening to these songs. You know, it's like really funk, but like R&B. It's like kind of like throwback R&B, but like it's kind of mixed in with like obviously modern R&B that we listen to right now. Victoria Monet is actually really freaking talented, man. Like, she's beautiful, she can dance, she can sing. You know, she has a lot of great crossovers with a lot of people this year. So, you know, if you haven't listened to Victoria Monet, you need to go listen to her. I also love the cover as well too. Like, can we talk about the cover? The cover is fire. So now number 9 spot is Jay Cinema with Brown Cinema. If you guys don't know who about Jay Cinema is, he's a New York native. He be performing like rap songs and shit. He's actually a really great friend of mine. I actually know him personally. So, you know, Jared, if you're listening, this side is for you. This album is a really great lo-fi, sample heavy, psychedelic, avant-garde hip-hop project. If you guys listen to like Mike, Earl Sweatshirt, Methane, and A Day I Came, you know, the people from Slums, you guys will really love his sound. You know what I'm saying? He kind of has like a very cohesive sound that be on point sometimes. You know, it's very melancholy. It's a very depressing and kind of melancholy album, but it has a very triumphant tone to it, where kind of like with some rap songs where it was kind of stuck in a lot of like looped and really like sad, like diatribe like songs, but it still kind of had a very like influential type of undertone to it. This is kind of what this album is. His producer definitely suited this man with some great ass hits that fit this man's aesthetic and his voice. So, you know, it got me through a lot of depression and BS, and it's personally an album I love to listen to a lot. So my favorite tracks off of it is I, Brown Cinema, Alone, Grown Now, Especially Night. There are some good features on here that you will definitely enjoy. So again, if you like Earl Sweatshirt, Mike, and all the other artists, check out Jay Cinema, Brown Sounds. I think they did a really good job. And out of all the projects that Jay had released this past year, I think that was the one I really enjoyed the most. Number 8 we have is Anonymous with Before the Night Is Over. He's a Florida rapper, you know what I'm saying? You know, pretty close with Denzel. Been listening to him since I was 14. I'm 20 now. So he's a really fantastic artist that has a lot of good concept, a lot of great wordplay, lyrics. You know, if you guys are really more into that aggressive and more lyric side, his flows for the most part on this album, on this EP, are really fantastic. Each song flows really well into one another. The versatility are really dope, from like R&B, hip hop, to funk. The way he combines these genres together is really fantastic. You know, there's a lot of awesome content on this EP, from just love, people switching up on you, trust issues, success, struggles that come with, you know, the music industry, being in the music industry, the rap game, and how it's very easily to be replaceable. Like, he actually talks about that on the song We'll Be in Love. You would think the song is about it's actually a love song, but he's actually using personification to actually talk about the rap game and how it's actually really easy for you to be replaced by somebody else that's big and popping in the industry. So it's actually really cool how he kind of switches up his flows, and again, his content is really like A1. It's definitely on point for the most part. My favorite tracks, obviously, is pretty much every single song, but if I had to pick one I really, really do love, it's really Long Night. Long Night is it be the bomb. It really be like, when you just driving with your homies and it's like late night and you don't really have much to do, you kind of just like, you know, cruising through, you just like seeing through the city through your with your windshield, bruh, Long Night's like the way to go. And there's only 5 tracks and it doesn't wear out your welcome. Number 7 we got is Logic with No Pressure, man. You guys already know Logic. He a father, a Twitch streamer now. He retired from the rap game since people have been kind of getting up his ass after his last 2 projects that he released. Y'all know the projects. This album really proved that Logic is back on rare form with this project. There's a lot of great Easter eggs that he kind of recalls back from his last projects, from like Under Pressure to like Tits and Everybody, and even Bobby Tarantino and the Young Sinatra series. There are a lot of great Easter eggs that you guys will definitely pick up, you know, with Thalia, you know, everybody from Tits. The production is A1 too. A lot of soulful chops. It's a love letter for like hip hop heads. If you guys love like Andre 3000, Outkast, Kanye, Lupe Fiasco, Kendrick, Jay-Z, you know, a lot of people that he paid a lot of homage to and referenced on song before. This is pretty much everything you would expect from a Logic project, but it's a lot more refined. It's a lot more trimmed down. He gets straight to the point. He's rapping. He's not talking about, you know, you might have some little cringe bars here or there, but it's not filler. It's not bullshit. You're not going to be hearing that through Logic throughout the rest of this album. He's actually just going to be rapping and rapping and rapping. And can we just talk about the cover real quick? Like, the cover is fantastic, yo. Shout out to Sam Spratt for always looking this man with the dopest covers that I probably even see, that I have ever seen in like hip-hop period. What I really like about this cover, it pays homage to his last, you know, with Under Pressure, when he was in a room with his homies. So that's really damn cool. It's very wholesome, it's funny, and it's very a lot of endearing lines, and you'll really find a song that you'll really like from this project, whether you are an extreme Logic fan or not. Just when you're like, even like you're a hip-hop head or a hip-hop stan, there's gonna be songs like Soul Food and Celebration that will just give you guys a really nice warm fuzzy feeling that's like kind of, you know, vintage in a way, you know what I'm saying? And again, like Logic, I really love about him is because he has so much love for the game that it's kind of sad that he's actually retiring, but hey, it is what it is. My favorite tracks, obviously, is being The Man I Is with that, you know, with that sample, and also that little trumpet with like doo-doo-doo-doo-doo. Definitely a nice callback to Spotty Dopealicious from Outkast. I cannot say that fucking name for the life of me. No Pressure, Celebration, and Amen, and heard him say great production on that. And it's a bittersweet moment for me, and I've always loved this man since high school. So Amen, if you're listening to this video, Logic, I hope your retirement goes well, man. So shout out to Logic for doing the damn thing on Damn's album. My sixth pick is Brent Faiyaz with The World. I can't, you know, even though I could, but you know, I got parents around here, all right? Anyway, the sixth part is about The World by Brent Faiyaz. If you ask me, this nigga's a fire ass nigga. get it? No, you guys are not getting it? Oh, all right, whatever. Cousin Fire, last name Fire, all right, whatever. This album is a very toxic album. Like, if you get over his voice and just actually listen to what he's, like, actually rapping about, this man is really toxic sometimes. Like, it's actually kind of dangerous and a little bit frightening how toxic and how vile his lyrics are. Like, he got that toxic alpha energy that a lot of women love, you know what I'm saying? Like, not a lot of women love, but a lot of women tend to kind of cling on to, I guess you could say. This EP is sort of like a soundtrack to all the toxic friendships I've been with, like, women and like, you know, even with my guys too, like, you know, them just like doing me dirty and shit. And I appreciate Brent Faiyaz, you know, just keeping it real, keeping it humble, you know what I'm saying, and always just, you know, being a humble guy to do it, you know what I'm saying? I always loved Brent Faiyaz for his voice, you know what I'm saying? And always having really glamorous, smooth, and dreamlike production. And, you know, he has that voice as well, too, that actually evokes that motion. It's kind of like with Frank Ocean. So I really do appreciate Brent Faiyaz for that. You know, my favorite tracks being Fuck the World, which I didn't like at first, but I really do. I grew to love it, like, oh, as the time went on. Rehab, definitely one of my favorite tracks, definitely a highlight for me on this project. And Bluffing, Skyline, and Clouded. So shout out to Brent Faiyaz, you know what I'm saying? I know it's high on the list, but listen, it's actually one of the artists of this list that I actually listened to the most of this year, because, you know, your boy been going through it, and sometimes a good project like that can get somebody through something. Now we're on to the top five. The top five. Lord have mercy. Looks like I have superpowers. Also, did you guys get superpowers on the 21st? Let me know about that too. My number fifth spot is The Weeknd's After Hours. We already know who The Weeknd is at this point. If you guys don't know, stop living under a rock. This man had a fantastic year despite of the coronavirus, man. Like, you know, we guys already know about the Grammy snub. We don't really need to talk about that one. He's actually my top number one listened artist of this year on Spotify and on Apple Music. So that should kind of give you a testament as to, you know, how great this album is and how great Abel really is. He had the best visuals and the best rollout for this project. If you go on his Instagram and, you know, you go, like, you know, even when the project didn't even release, like, the music videos, like Heartless, Blinding Lights, and After Hours, like, there was, like, a little, like, film, little short film that he did. Like, the rollout for this project was really damn fire, and every single, like, live performance on this album was fantastic. Gave me a lot of Trilogy and Someone Dear Melancholy vibes while I was listening to this project, because it's pretty dark, you know. It kind of deals with a lot of dark self-loathing and, you know, self-loathing, overindulgence type of things. You guys know, if you listen to Abel, you know, with party and the drugs and the women, you know what I'm saying? But Abel always does it in a way that it's really refreshing, and it's always, you know, nice to always hear him change up his sound. Like, you could definitely tell, like, you know, not one, like, this project does not sound like this project. You might get, like, vibes, or you might get, like, similarities to this project, but he's always changed up the sound, which I really do like about Abel. He's never always stayed stagnant, which is really cool. You know what I'm saying? Awesome 80s synth punk, new wave production sound. Like, the production here is killer. You guys already know the message when it comes to Abel, man. Like, I don't even need to explain it. I love this project. Definitely got me through a lot this year, you know what I'm saying? My favorite tracks is being with Faith, After Hours, In Your Eyes, Hardest to Love, Blinding Lights, and Save Your Tears, you know what I'm saying? So shout out to Abel for doing the damn thing on After Hours. We love you, the Grammys. My number four spot actually is Mac Miller's Circles. You know, Mac Miller is one of those artists that was really beloved around the, you know, the hip hop and the music game. You know, when he had passed away, you know, it was definitely devastating that year when we lost a lot of hip hop artists that same year. John Broyan, I think that's how you say his last name. I cannot remember, but you guys know what I'm talking about. I'll put a little thing on here. You guys, you know, can correct me on the comments if I'm saying his name wrong. But he made this album, like, it's one of those albums where it was made with a labor of love. Usually with posthumous albums, they just kind of throw in like songs just for the label to kind of feed off of the artist, you know, their legacy while they're still, while they were kind of still relevant. But John really took his time with this album and took what he worked with when Mac was working on Swimming and really refined it and added some bells and whistles that I don't think I've really heard on a Mac Miller project. Hell, not even on Swimming before. You know what I'm saying? This album always kept me feeling eased, peaceful, relieful. I don't even know if that's a word, but relaxed, a meditative vibe when I listen to it. I love listening to it when I'm like walking around my block. It's probably the best time to really listen to this project, really, like during night times and shit like that, when you're really going through it. It's definitely a musical embodiment of Mac Miller's spirit. Like I said before, when he's working on Swimming, this album was supposed to be paired up with Swimming in Circles, which is a really dope ass concept, considering that he's always kind of brought up that topic even in his last project and even in this project as well too, which is really damn cool. It's a nice funk soul hip-hop project that really puts us into Mac Miller's world, and you know, of sense of morality, of growth and struggle in his life, you know, that he was, you know, talking about, mixed in with a lot of nice witty wordplay, you know, like really talking his shit, you know what I'm saying? A lot of dope bars on this project that really made me respect Mac, and it really sucks that he's gone from the world. I can't really appreciate the awesome work that he did, you know. And again, John and his team, what they did, you know. And praise to his family for, you know, allowing us to really like listen to Malcolm and really like getting more of a sense of what he was working on and what his headspace was when he was listening and working on this album. My favorites obviously being with That's On Me, Can't See, Everybody, Complicated, Circles in Hand. So shout out to Mac Miller, rest in peace. I apologize, man, again, that, you know, he's dead. But you know what, like, I can't get sad at this project. I can only just really be more happy that, I guess, not to say he's gone, but like happy that, in the sense that I can kind of take away this knowing that Mac, he's in a better world, he's in a better place, and I can, you know, take this album and try to live life to the best of my abilities. All right, we got the top three. Number three is TK Menza with Last Year Was Weird Volume 2. This is the second installment to her Last Year Was Weird little trilogy, which I think the next one is going to be coming out next year. Don't quote me on that. Don't know. But she's from Zimbabwe, you know, my African sister, you know what I'm saying? Let's freaking get it, you know what I'm saying? She's super versatile. She makes a lot of great dance, pop, electronic, house music, R&B music, hip-hop music. Her flows are fantastic throughout this project. Her lyrics are really straightforward, straight to the point, but like mixed with a lot of witty, a lot of cool, and a lot of nice references. She makes a lot of references to Tetris, by the way, like on this project. The music videos are really fire as well too, extremely creative, like the visuals, mwah, gorgeous for this project. Like, she definitely, TK definitely did the thing with this little EP that she had dropped. Also, she kind of reminds me of Patronata, but I feel like with artists that, you know, are on a Patronata project, I feel like she's definitely coming to her own, and I feel like she's tucking that sound and really honed that sound, and I think it really worked for her style considering how she is as an artist. My favorite tracks obviously being from 24K, Awake with JPEG Mafia, shout out to JPEG Mafia, Shook, PB Jam, and Grasshopper. Shout out to TK. Definitely one of the best EPs of this year. Shout out to the girl. She did her damn thing on this. Number two is Run the Jewels 4, RTJ 4. You guys know who RTJ 4 is. You guys don't know. Killer Mike, LP, the duo. LP does the production and the rapping. Killer Mike also does the rapping as well too. They've been killing it for the past decade now. If you guys haven't listened to their past three albums up until this point, please go listen to them. They're fire as hell. But this is more of a socially political charged album, more than, you know, even RTJ3, which kind of had more of a serious political tone. But this one is more ramped up more than ever. And it's funny because I think it was one of the songs called Walking in the Snow, where I think Killer Mike had recorded that last year regarding to the Eric Garner's story. I think. But, you know, considering what recent events, you know, with George Floyd, you know, I Can't Breathe, that line, you know, with that first second half of the song, it's fan-freaking-tastic. It actually hits home, and it's really scary how it actually relates to our times now. But yeah, the creativity, the artistry on this album is off the chain. Like, the beats on here are fantastic. If I don't even know what is my favorite RTJ project, because all of them are so fire. Like, I had RTJ 3 as my favorite. This might low-key be my favorite out of the RTJ little catalog that they've had so far. It's so amazing, man. Like, these guys just never disappoint with the quality of their music. Great hooks, great guest performances, you know what I'm saying, with Pharrell and Gangsta Boo. She does her thing on this, man. That's just goddamn walking in the snow. Goddamn that motherfucker coat. You know, part of 3-6. Love her on this project. Yeah, it's just a great hip-hop, hardcore hip-hop project, man. Like, if you guys don't know about these guys, you guys need to get in tune with them. Like, they're just that fire, okay? Like, and their chemistry is just completely unmatched as well too. Like, they've always killed it when it comes to this, when it comes to every project of theirs. My favorite tracks obviously is being with A Few Words from the Firing Squad, Walking in the Snow, Just, Yankee and the Brave, and Ooh La La. Oh, wee. You dig? So shout out to RTJ, shout out to LP and Killer Mike for doing a damn thing, for talking about what needs to be talked about in the damn America. Y'all did y'all thing on this project. Y'all need to go listen to this project. Then, my number one favorite album of this year. It's Leland LaHavis's self-titled. I love this project so much. It got me through a lot this year. I love this woman. I didn't think this would be my favorite album of the year, but it's only right for me to really, you know, put it on my favorite album of the year. I didn't know about her up until this year. I think I heard about Weird Fishes, you know what I'm saying? That was the first song I heard from her. And then I listened to Bittersweet and Paper Thin, the singles from this album. And I was like, oh wow, I have to like listen to this album when it comes out. And oh my God, it's so beautiful. It's so healing. It's so revealing. It's so vulnerable. She definitely wears her heart on her sleeves when it comes to this project. Like, this album really taught me so much about myself, to love myself, to appreciate myself, to appreciate the life I have on earth, to appreciate the things that I, you know, that I always took for granted in my life. You know, this project really brought me, you know, healed my wounds. It definitely brought me to a place of peace and prosperity and freedom. I felt free on this project. And you know, she talks about a lot of relationship, a lot of relationship themes on this project, you know, because this album was actually inspired on a little, you know, on actually a relationship that Leland was actually in. And you know, she kind of wrote from that heart, from that perspective, on this project. And you know, I think she did a really fantastic job, you know, with her vocal arrangements, with her hooks, with the melodies, and you know, every single song really hits home for me. You know what I'm saying? Every, you know, bit, I would say my favorite song is freaking Sour Flower. Like, that song, every time when I listen to it, I wake up, I smile, and I'm getting ready for a wonderful day that awaits me. This album always puts me in a fantastic meditative mood when I'm angry, when I'm upset, and I just need to get back into ground zero. This album reminds me of why I love earth so much and why it's necessary to be on this planet. So shout out to Leland LaHavis for making one of my favorite albums of 2000, my favorite albums, for making it my album of the year of 2020. So shout out to Leland LaHavis. I love you, girl. This album brings back that our traditional R&B project, R&B sound. Like, you know, if you listen to like Alicia Keys, you know, it definitely has like that vintage, you know, R&B sound that I feel like R&B needs and is missing nowadays. And it just brings me back, you know what I'm saying, from the early 2000s. And it's fantastic, like all the way around. And so I'm just really, it's a very healing project. It's a really healing project, from Leland being upset and mad, you know, with this relationship, to now she's, you know, kind of like, you know, thinking about what's going on and just trying to like, you know, cope with a lot of things that's going on in the relationship, and just trying to, like, you know, figure things out with her partner, and even, you know, still, like, just kind of moving forward and just moving on with life. And the way she handled that, it's a beautiful metamorphosis, and, you know, it's a truly beautiful project. So again, we don't have this self-titled, my favorite album of the year. But that is my fit. Those are my, oh, before I end this video, I have a couple of honorable mentions. I death forgot about that. So we got Big Sean with Detroit 2, Samia with Remedial Education, Freddie Gibbs with Alfredo, Rita Sariana with Sariyama, Benny the Butcher with Burden of Proof, Liv with Couldn't Wait to Tell You, Denzel Curry, Blood In, Blood Out EP, 21 Savage and Metro Boomin with Savage Mode 2, Charles Gambino with 3-15-20, Jason Momoa with Better Days Ahead, Joey Badass with The Light Pack, J Electronica with A Rent Testimony, Industry Games with Chica, Chica with Industry Games, Don Toliver, Heaven or Hell, Thundercat, It Is What It Is, Chalbino, Jenny Aiko, Denzel Curry, Unlocked with Kenny Beats, JPEG Mafia with EP, Bryson Tiller with Anniversary, Giveon with It's All When It's All Said and Done, Pop Smoke with Meet the Woo 2, Amine with Libo, and J Cinema with Peace of Mind, Mind of Peace, and Chloe and Holly with Ungodly Hour. That is my honorable mention. This has been my favorite albums of this year. Let me guys know what your favorite albums of this year was. I hope you guys enjoyed this list. It took a while for me to really get this list done and together. I know I kind of stumbled and I kind of fucked up a few times in this video, but I just wanted to get this damn video done before the New Year's. But I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Let me guys know what your favorite part of this video was, and I'll see you guys on 2021. I love you guys, and Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, Happy Kwanzaa, whatever you celebrate. And I hope you guys have a wonderful New Year, and 2021 will be our year. Best believe that. So stay safe, wash your hands, social distance, and I'll see you guys next year. I love y'all. Thank you guys so much for supporting this channel throughout this year, and I'll see you guys next time. Peace!